In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And in Him was life, and this life was the light. And John says to us that darkness will never, ever put out light. And this is what I experienced when I went to Israel. And I would like you to come with me on this journey and enjoy the Bible coming alive. And of course, Capernaum, it's just ruins. There's just ruins. But the most amazing thing is, here's the synagogue, the ruins of the synagogue, and there's Peter's house. And Peter's house was the house in Capernaum. It's the biggest coming together place. It's like the whole Bible gets another taste. It gets another flavor. It's like a black and white sketch that gets colored. And you understand, why is this? Why is that? Why is this?
This is the village that is called Capernaum. Don't ask me exactly where he was sleeping, where he was living, in the whole location here. One thing we know, Peter's house. It's under this church. This church, my opinion, they shouldn't build it. But they build it on top of Peter's house. From here, you could go to Syria, Syria, Mesopotamia. This is part of the Via Maris Road, Odyssey Road. And this is the place that from all the location around here, all the villages that we have, used to come to this place to work and to do grounding the mill. And of course, olive oil they used to do here. And what we know, that Jesus was teaching the kids in the synagogue. And I'm going to show you the synagogue that was built, foundation, is from the time of Christ.
This is the synagogue in Capernaum where Jesus actually took the scroll and said, "This is fulfilled in your midst today." Wow, such a privilege to be here. After Jesus fed the 5,000, it's like the people just didn't believe. He took them right on the sea into the storm. And when they were crying, he says, "You still don't believe. You still don't believe." And then straight away, he took his disciples and he walked like 50, 60 kilometers to the Golan Heights. Guys, you've got to see the terrain where they walked. Why would Jesus walk there to Caesarea Philippi? When you get there, you realize, uh-oh, what's going on here? This is the eye where the Jordan is fed from. There was fountains coming out of the ground, and it was going down this rift valley, which is the African rift that goes right from the Golan Heights right down to Elat at the bottom where it goes into the Red Sea. And this is just an amazing, amazing place. Of course, Satan always tries to get the best spot. So what they did there is they made the temple of the god of Pan. Oh my word. It was the biggest idolatry worship center in the whole of Israel. This was the heart of idolatry of Rome.
Okay, everybody. All right, this is a very, very important site. And this is the very site where Jesus came with his disciples. That means all his disciples came right here to the site. Jesus asked them a question right in front of what you see here. Because right here, right at the time of Christ, here's an artistic impression of the power of Rome, which was the sanctuary of Pan. Because in the amongst the Romans, right, they worshipped the god called Pan. That was the religious system. So Jesus came and stood right here in Caesarea Philippi. And he asked his disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I am?" Then they said, some said John the Baptist, some said Elijah, some said one of the prophets. Then he says, "But who do you say that I am?" Right? He wasn't asking the question anywhere else. He came to ask the question right in front of the strength of Rome. Right? Who am I as compared to what they hold in esteem, the god called Pan? So then Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." As soon as he said that, Jesus said, "I give you the keys of the kingdom." And the gates, says it, the gates of hell. He called this power idolatry, the gates of hell. He said, "The gates of hell will not prevail against the church." Why? We believe in the living God. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God.
Everywhere you go, you see, you see Roman ruins.
Not all of you stand up. You're sitting, you don't even know on what you're sitting. Stand up, mommy. Stand up. And have a look here, you don't even realize how you're sitting. You see what you're doing? You see? You cannot pull it. This is considered the keystone. Yeah. The middle stone of God. You see? How to make flesh. And this is the strongest way to have a roof. On this stage, 24 hours, constantly. Go to show. The show is going from different sides, entering into the ball. You don't need a loudspeaker. What you need is just to see and look what happened. Look at a couple of the three people standing on top. Look at all the marble and all the seats. And behind them is missing the seats. Where is the marble behind it? We couldn't find it. But you remember what we saw in Capernaum? Maybe some of this marble was taken from here, moved to that side, and carved it different way. Because this is a type of a marble that whenever you walk around the country and you see this kind of marble, immediately without even questioning it. This is only Romans brought it in. If I walk with you and I'll tell you that is done by the Byzantine, Roman Christian, 3rd century. But then you will see it's in a different way. How you find out? Because the 3rd century, you see already that they're carving a cross. And the Romans didn't carve crosses.
only at the 3rd century. Now, around the seats, you will see like a back seat. This is what they used to call it, the orchestra. It's only the very important people that have been sitting around like that. You don't need here a loudspeaker. You can stand and the acoustic will carry it up to the top.
But here is the heart of it. Oh my word. Now all the buildings are broken down and shattered and it's all lying around. And I was thinking the other day, just the fact that all these great civilizations, there's nothing left of them, but the word is still alive. The places are still there proving the word is. We just have to understand that nothing man can build up is eternal, but what God does is eternal. But we were standing there, and this is where Jesus, I can just see him walk right to that place. And then he said to Peter, "Who do men say I am?" And Peter said, "The people say this and that and this and that and this." He says, "But Peter, who do you say?" And he said, "You son of man, you're the son of God." And he says, "Flesh and blood have not revealed this to you." We're standing in the biggest place what flesh and blood could produce. And flesh and blood is no competition for the Spirit of God. And he said, "On this rock I will build my church." And the rock is not Peter. I know people say that it's on Peter. Peter was the leader. But it's like just previously, Jesus said, any man that hears my word and do it is like a man that digs deep and builds his house on the rock. And I'm telling you, where a man has built on the rock, this is where God is going to build his house. Come on, the whole Bible fits together. It's so awesome. And he said this right in front of the biggest pagan place, "I give to you the keys of the kingdom. What you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. What you bind in heaven will be bound on earth." The keys of the kingdom. Guys, he didn't give us the keys of a denomination or a church building. He gave us the keys of the kingdom, which is the third and final world that Ephesians talks about. It's glory be to God in the church, a world without end. Wow. It's so, so awesome. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And this is what I think. The whole of Israel is proof that nothing is going to stop what God is going to do. The reality of what Jesus Christ did for us was right there. God bless you. See you next time.